Hello friends, as part of Sales Speed, let's have a discussion on current affairs for today. And the topics we are going to discuss on the prelims would be MSMED and the Solar Charkha Mission and Tekton on Poshan Abhiyan would be discussed on the prelims topics. And editorial discussion, we are going to discuss the transplanting best practices and tainted by uranium pollution. So these are the topics we are going to look at the editorial discussion. So let's start with the first topics for today. So that is the Udyam Sangam. So here the news is that the president inaugurates the Udyam Sangam to mark the UNMSME Day. So in this context, we will be looking at, so what is the theme of this MSME Day and the significance of this sector and the changing criteria that is proposed by the cabinet as well as the new initiatives that is initiated by the government of India. And particularly, we will be wrapping with this topic by comprehensively discussing the Solar Charkha Mission. So let's have a discussion on this UNMSME Day. So here, so last year it was the first MSME Day. So internationally recognized the importance of the micro, small, medium sized enterprises. So in achieving the sustainable developmental goals and also the promoting the innovation, creativity, sustainable work for all. And today, on 27th June of 2018 is the second anniversary of UNMSME Day. And the theme of this present year is Youth Dimension. That is the centrality of youth force in leveraging the potential of this sector. So that is the very theme of this present day. And in this context, we would be looking at what is the significance of this MSME sector. Here, the sector contributes about 8% to the country's GDP and 45% to the manufactured output, as well as 40% of country's exports comes from this sector. So also this MSME sector contributes about 60% of employment, so of the total employment in the country, and the total it contributes heavily, so much more than the heavy industrial units. So that is the very significance of this MSME sector. So furthermore, the role of MSME sector in leveraging the demographic dividend of the country and promoting the inclusive growth, and this is the very, very significant aspect of this MSME sectors. So in order to leverage the demographic dividend as well as inclusive employment generation, this sector has to be given very, very priority. So that is the very significance of this MSME sectors. So coming to the changing criteria, already you know that as per the MSME sector, MSME Act, we have very classification of this micro, small, medium enterprises based on the investment cap. Particularly in manufacturing sector, the investment cap is up to 25 lakhs in the micro category sector, and small sector it is up to 5 crores, and medium manufacturing enterprises, the cap of investment in the plant and machinery is up to 10 crores. Whereas in case of services sectors, so the micro service sector, the investment in the equipment is up to 10 lakhs, whereas the medium it is up to 5 crores. So now the government is planning, and the government wants to revamp this MSME sectors by moving from investment-based classification to the revenue-based approach, that is the annual turnover-based. And no more, if the parliament accepts this cabinet proposals, so there won't be any classification of manufacturing enterprises as well as service sector. Very single classification, so differentiates the micro enterprises, small enterprises and medium enterprises. Here the classification is based on the revenue approach, not based on the investment approach. So that's what I said, the annual turnover approach. If the annual turnover is up to 5 crores, then it is known as micro enterprises. If the annual turnover is up to 75 crores and exceeding 5 crores, it is known as small enterprises. And if the annual turnover is more than 75 crores and up to the 25 crores, then it is a medium enterprises. And this is the proposed criteria, and once the parliament approves this criteria, then it is going to be the criteria for the classification of this micro, small, medium enterprises. And why this criteria is needed? So this criteria is very relevant in the present dynamic changing of the environment, so particularly in promoting the ease of doing business, as well as in order to compatible with the present new taxation system, that is the GST system. So these are the major reasons for again going for the changing the criteria of this MSME sector. So it is a developing topic. Now coming to the new initiatives on this context of this UNMSMED. So the government of India has conducted Udyam Sangam. It is a day-long conclave, so involving the all stakeholders with respect to the MSME sectors. So here the major purpose is to consolidating the convergence and synergy of all the government initiatives relating to these MSME sectors. So right from knowledge, marketing, technical, financial assistance, so in order to leverage the potential of these MSME sectors. So I could say that Udyam Sangam is a conclave involving all the stakeholders with respect to this MSME sector. So another initiatives that are taken by the government of India is that Sampark. This Sampark and Udyam Sakhi are the portal-based MSME ministry initiatives. So this Sampark portal act as a bridge between the talent pool and the those enterprises seeking the trained human resources. But in case of human, in case of particularly with respect to the women, so Udyam Sakhi portal was launched. Another very important mission that was launched under this occasion is that Solar Charkha mission. So in this context, we'll be looking at the Solar Charkha mission. So in prelims perspective, this Charkha mission is very, very important. So kindly note that this Charkha mission, so it's not an initiative of the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy Resources, but it is an initiative of Ministry of Micro, Small, Medium Enterprises. Kindly note it. So what is the objective of this Charkha mission? So Charkha mission will generate employment in rural areas and contributes to the green economy. So by adapting the Charkhas, that is the spinning wheels based on the solar energy. So solar energy would be integrated with the Charkha mission, Charkhas, so that the potential of the solar energy would be leveraged. So this mission is going to cover at least 50 clusters, and each cluster will employ about 400 to 2000 artisans, and the ministry, that is the micro, small, medium enterprises ministry, so will leverage the subsidy amount of 550 crores. So that the objective, what is the objective? I said that it is going to generate the employment and adapting this solar based technology with respect to the textile industries. And one of the objective is to employ 1 lakh women in each parliamentary constituency and cover them under social security schemes. So this is also one of the component of this mission, and the scheme itself aims to increase the khadi sales in the countries. So these are the very important points you have to keep it in mind in prelims dimension. Next topic, that is the Tekton on Poshan Abhiyan. So what is a Poshan means? It is a Prime Minister overreaching scheme for holistic nourishment. Here the news is that Ministry of Women and Child Development Ministry is going to organize Tekton seminar on Poshan Abhiyan. So in this context, we would be looking at why this Tekton is needed. So what is the major objective of this Poshan Abhiyan, and what are the major strategies or key initiatives that are initiated under this Abhiyan? So would be looked under this Poshan Abhiyan. So Poshan Abhiyan Tekton is aimed at improving the nutrition outcomes through effective monitoring and early intervention. So that is the objective of this Tekton. It is a just like seminar involving the all stakeholders with respect to this implementation of this Poshan Abhiyan. So it's effective. Also one of the component is that, so they wanted to promote the Jan Andolan, so towards nutrition. So primarily involving the awareness aspect. So already you know that the National Nutrition Mission, so is a very high frequency topic, and this Poshan Abhiyan or the National Nutrition Mission has been in the news for considerable length of the time, and it is a very high frequency topic. So you should be very, very careful. So in reading this, particularly the topic, you have to focus comprehensively and understand completely, so that any question that is framed on this topic has to be answered very effectively. So this National Nutrition Mission targets to reduce four aspects. I could say the four elements are that the stunting, undernutrition, anemia, and reducing the low birth weight at the time of birth. So every year they want to reduce by 2%, 2%, 3 and 2%. So with respect to stunting, undernutrition, anemia, as well as reducing the low birth weight at the time of birth. So although the target of reducing stunting is at least 2% per annum, so this mission aims to achieve the stunting has to be reduced to 25% by 2022. Now, one of the very important initiative under this Poshan Abhiyan is establishment of this National Nutrition Councils. So you might be confused that this National Nutrition Council so might be headed by the Prime Minister or Ministry related to this Ministry of Human and Child Development, but it is not the case. This council is headed by the Vice Chairman of NITI Aayog. So what is the function of this National Nutrition Council is that, so it was set up as per the Poshan Abhiyan, and mainly it will be apex body to formulate the overall policies and guide monitor the nutrition based schemes. I could say that the mandate of this council is that, so right from the policy directions, the coordination, as well as the reviewing of this implementation, so is the mandate of this council. This is also to be given priority. So now coming to the components or pillars of this mission. So here, so just to go through these components, so very, very important components, right from ICDS CAS platform, it is a web portal of the Ministry of Human and Child Development. All the data are from the objectives, implementation, present status of this ICDS is available under this portal. So the convergence, behavioral change, ICEC, that is information, education, communication, advocacy, training aspect, innovation aspect, incentives aspect, so also the grievance redressal. These are the major pillars of this mission. So now coming to the key strategies. As I said that this Poshan Abhiyan is a very important topic and a high frequency topic. So you should understand and read the topic very comprehensively. So right from this pillars, strategies, National Nutrition Councils, all aspects has to be given priorities. So you just go through this key strategies with respect to the nutrition mission. So right from infant and young child feeding, the food and nutrition, immunization, institutional delivery, wash awareness, dewarming, ORS, food fortification, dietary diversification, adolescent nutrition, maternal health and nutrition. So all components, all the strategies now given priority. So in order to achieve the objective of this Poshan Abhiyan mission. As I said that Poshan Abhiyan involves the convergence of various ministries. So more than 10 ministries are involved under this Abhiyan. So here the Ministry of Human and Child Development is the nodal ministry, but this ministry is coordinating right from NITI Aayog, Health and Family Affairs, Tribal Affairs, Urban Development, Rural Development, Consumer Affairs Ministry, and also the Department of School Education, Information and Broadcasting Ministry, Panchayat Raj Ministry, and Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation. So these ministries are coordinated by Ministry of Human and Child Development. So what is the major impact of this mission? So as I said that the mission aims to reduce the stunting, undernutrition, anemia, and low birth weight. So this is the very objective of and major impact of this Poshan Abhiyan. Now moving on to next topic, that is the editorial topics. So we have picked up two editorial topics, that is the transplanting best practices with respect to the transplantation of human organs. Our next topic is tainted by uranium. Here the first editorial is that transplanting the best practices. So this editorial talks about the present controversy with respect to the transplantation of human organs. So in this context, we would be looking at the present controversy, what are the reasons, what are the existing provisions, and what needs to be done. So these are the different dimensions we would be looking at this particular topic. So here the present controversy is that, so the controversy in India over large percentage of the foreign nationals receiving the heart transplants from the deceased donors in India. So that is the present crisis, that is the present controversy, and it is very evident from the leaked WhatsApp message of the head of the NOTO. NOTO means National Organ and Tissue Plantation Organization. Here the reasons for this present crisis is that because this transplantation activities is mainly dominated by the private sector, the private healthcare sectors, and there are market pressures and high amount of money is involved in the transplantation. So that's why the local people are not affordable, and there is a opaque policy, and it is completely not transparent, not accountable to the greater extent, and these are the very reasons for the present crisis, I could say that. So in this context, we would be looking at so the existing provisions. So already we discussed these three components in the 14th June edition of video. So in this video, you could be having the complete details right from the national program, organ transplantation, major objectives, and also the provisions of this act, that is known as the Transplantation of Human Organs Act, and the classification and the coordination, so right from NOTO to SOTO. So I could say that the government of India, through this national program on organ transplantation, so the one of the objective is that, so the poor people, the needy people, has to be given the harvested organs. So this program is implemented, so by this Transplantation Act, this TOHUA Act, that is the Transplantation of Human Organs Act, so is enacted by the parliament. As you know that the public health is a state subject, the parliament came up with the Transplantation of Human Organs Act in order to effectively implement the national program on transplantation, organ transplantation. And the major objective of this TOHUA Act is to uniformity throughout the country. So right from harvesting, storage, as well as transplantation, so various organizations were installed. So kindly note that these organizations, that is NOTO, ROTO, SOTO, that is National Organ and Tissue Transplantation Organization, a Regional Organ and Tissue Transplantation Organization, and State Organ and Tissue Transplantation Organizations are not established by this TOHUA Act. So that's why these are not a statutory bodies. So some of these SOTO or ROTO are established or registered under Societies Registration Act. So this NOTO to SOTO mainly established to implement this act. So that is the existing provisions with respect to this transplantation of human organs. So what needs to be done? So I could say that while the act of donation is a public act, the public people, the poor people should be given priority. So strengthening the capacity of the public sector healthcare, subsidizing the transplantation so that the poor people who are in needy but not in financial state and financial position to get the benefit of this organ transplantation has to be given subsidization, and also affirmative action, that is the reservation policy in case of allocation of these human organs also be to be considered, so in order to effectively implement this policy by ensuring the transparency and accountability. And major tool is also the awareness. So these are the certain aspects. So you have to focus with respect to this transplantation of human organs. And this topic has been in the news for considerable length of the time. So you should know the complete details of this topic. So in prelims perspective as well as mains perspective. Now coming to the tainted by uranium. So this editorial topic talks with respect to the contamination of drinking water by uranium. So in this context, we'll be looking at what is the present situation, what is the WHO limit with respect to the uranium, and the harmful effects of uranium, and the recent observation by the environmental science paper, and what needs to be done. So these are the certain aspects we'll be looking under this uranium contamination in drinking water. So here the present situation is that, so based on the reports of widespread, so in India, there is a widespread contamination of uranium in the groundwater, and it demands very urgent response. So that is the based on the reports. So the report found that, so more than WHO prescribed limit, so that is the WHO prescribed limit is 30 milligrams per liter. So that is a safe limit. But in based on the reports, right from northwestern, southern and southern, southeastern places of India, this contamination, that is the uranium contamination in groundwater, is more than 30 micrograms per liter. So it's a more than WHO limitation. So drinking water such as contaminated with uranium can affect the kidneys. So that is the major impact of this contamination of uranium. Again, in 2015, there is a study with respect to the Bangalore city. So the uranium levels were found. So note that more than 2000 micrograms per, micrograms per liter. Even in southern parts of, the Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh, certain areas are contaminated with uranium. So more than 500 milligrams per liter. So that is the present situation with respect to the contamination of uranium in India, and the situation demands very urgent response. So here, So the harmful effects of why the contamination of uranium is very harmful. So there is no very effective study, but based on the observation, based on the the pool of observation and studies, so the heavy metal damages kidneys, but also could damage almost every part of the human body. So the chronic effects of uranium is still unknown. So this is the very harmful effects of uranium. So again, so this study, this contamination of drinking water, so is again substantiated by the recent observation by environmental science observations. Environmental science paper observation says that, so identify two types of terrains in India with respect to heavy metal contamination. So that is, first part is the Rajasthan and other northwestern regions, uranium occurs mostly in alluvial aquifers. But in case of southern regions like Telangana, the crystalline rocks, so mainly the granite is the source of contamination. So already you know that the arsenic contamination, so in West Bengal, so the research is came to the light that, so the combination of both the factors, that is the geological factor as well as the chemical factors, are responsible for the contamination of arsenic in the Ganga Belt region. So the one of the harmful effects of this arsenic pollution is lung cancer. So here even, so the geological aspect is that, so the right from the aquifers to the chemical aspect is that if the uranium is exposed to air, so it could trigger the release and could contaminate with the air as well as the water. So what needs to be done? So what needs to be done should be very effective and very efficient. So the contaminated uranium as well as arsenic groundwater mapping should be taken immediately. So we don't have any comprehensive study of entire India where the uranium is contaminated with the drinking water. So wherever the contamination of uranium exceeds more than the safe limit, so alternative drinking water sources under National Drinking Water Program has to be given priority. So the priority of studying of harmful chronic effects also be given importance, and mysterious chronic kidney problems. So like Srikakulam. So in Srikakulam district of Andhra Pradesh, there is a place called Uddanam. So in Uddanam, there is a chronic kidney problems. So still date, the scientist not able to find the reason for chronic kidney problems. So might be one of the reason is that, so their drinking water might be contaminated with the heavy metals. Again, the Bureau of Indian Standards does not specify right from the norm for uranium contamination. So therefore, the administrative action with respect to the Bureau of BIS has to be given very, very important. The public has to be given awareness. So these are the aspects we have to be cautious with respect to the contamination of the uranium. So with this, we are closing the session. Thank you.